If you don't know, I'm a gigantic LeBron fan. I think he's, I mean, I'm not going out on a limb. He's, you know, otherworldly. He's great for the game. But the way he's gone about the whole Cleveland thing, where he might leave at the end of the, it's impossible to build a team that way. I think as great as he is and what he's meant to that organization and that city, I think that a lot of this mess is on his back because of the games he plays, and he has every right to play them about staying, going, committing, not committing. I think that's a big reason for this.
You're 100% right, and it's very accurate to say that. You think about this. Basically, everything associated with that team, probably with the exception of Kyrie being traded, is LeBron's doing. It's his choosing. The guys that are there that he wants to be there, the coach is there that he wants to coach the team. So LeBron has built this to a large extent. And what you just said about him leaving by a free agency and that really being the black cloud that's hanging over this team, it's fair. And I'm going to make a statement at the Cavs that you can't make about any other team in the NBA, and that's this. There is not a single player on their team that is part of their future. Think about the league. Even the young, bad teams, there are guys there that you think are going to be there 5-6 years down the road that are part of their future. All of the contending teams have players on their roster that you expect to be there in 4 or 5 years. There is no one on Cleveland's roster that will even be there 2 years from now. It's the most unique situation I've seen in sports. And LeBron James, it's like a game of Jenga, and LeBron James is the entire bottom floor of the wooden tower. And when he leaves, the entire thing falls apart, and everybody there knows that. And I think that is contributing to their apathy and their disinterest and their lack of trust and lack of feeling like you're part of something bigger. That's how they look right now when they're playing.
So when you talk about personnel changes, how much does LeBron get involved in those changes? And can you trust him to do that when you know he's walking at the end of the year?
That's a great point, and that's why Kobe Altman from day one has been in a really tough spot. And look, he did the best he could getting Kyrie Irving wanting to be traded dumped in his lap right after he gets on the job. I mean, that's a very difficult situation to handle. He did the best he could in getting what he thought was value in return. Everyone really lauded him at the time for what he got back, considering the fact that when a guy demands out, it's really because of buyer's market, but he still did very well. And the crown jewel of that, by the way, is the pick from Brooklyn, and depending how high that pick ends up being. So he did the best that he could, but he's in a really tough spot here because, you know, if you have LeBron, it's incumbent upon you as a front office person to do everything you can to win it every year because you don't know how long you're going to have him. You don't know how long he's going to stay healthy. You don't know how long he's going to be in his prime. So if you have a guy like that, you've got to do everything you can to win, particularly this year because this could be the last year he ever plays in Cleveland. So that's where he's in a tough spot in weighing how much do you mortgage some of the things you have for the future, knowing that maybe you don't get better, but you're trying to stockpile if LeBron leaves. How do you weigh that against trying to win right now? That's a very difficult proposition for him, particularly in regards to that pick, which is the one thing that teams covet that they have. If you move that to bring in a veteran, younger veteran star player that can help you win this year, and LeBron walks anyway, now you've given up what you think could be the asset to help you hit the reset button.
The one thing that I don't understand, and it's been explained to me, and I still don't understand the explanation, all right, Kyrie Irving wanted to be traded. No. And LeBron told Dan Gilbert no, because even if LeBron leaves at the end of the year, well, that solves the problem. Kyrie didn't have a good relationship with LeBron, and he would then be the man. Why did they ever trade him for a flawed guard who was out for half of the season, who can't guard anybody defensively? I don't understand the trade. I mean, they made Boston the better team.
Yeah, I think what you had there was a young front office person that really was worried about this becoming this massive distraction heading into the season where it was going to become untenable. And now, you know, you'd have a real messy situation on your hands. So they tried to take a player that made it very clear he didn't want to be there, and they made calls around the league to see what they could get in return. And when they thought about the prospect of a healthy Isaiah Thomas, who they thought would look like he looked last year for at least half a season, plus Jay Crowder, which was an upgrade over Richard Jefferson, who was playing a lot of those minutes a year ago, plus the pick, Kobe Altman viewed that about as good a deal as you're going to get in that situation. So they went ahead and made the move, and it was a little bit premature because I think if Kyrie's there, he's going to continue to play, and they're a better team. and you're going to have a team that we're all expecting to go back to the finals. But as it stands now, if this team, you know, the playoffs started tomorrow, they're not favored. They wouldn't even be favored against Toronto if the playoffs started right now.
So is there a deal that could be made that would change that?
Well, I do. Look, right now, you know, the one deal that sounds like it's getting more and more substance to it and more concrete is the George Hill deal. Now, people might look at that and say, well, George Hill, you know, it's a big deal. It's an average player. How's he going to help you? No, he's better than that. And you're giving up two guys that have no purpose for you whatsoever. Channing Frye and Amon Shumpert don't have any value to the Cavaliers at all. George Hill comes in, infinitely better perimeter defender than anyone you're running out there right now at the guard spot. And they've got about five guys that play two guards that get minutes. He's better than any of those guys defensively. He is a more than adequate three-point shooter. He's a veteran that's played in a ton of playoff games, and he's younger than what you have. George Hill would be a nice addition. It would help them on the perimeter be able to keep the ball in front of them much better, take the pressure off of Isaiah Thomas to allow him to do a lot what Curry does in Golden State, which is let the two guard the elite point guards and protect Isaiah Thomas on the weaker of the two perimeter players. They don't have that luxury right now. And until Isaiah Thomas is never going to be a good defender, but at least when he gets healthy and gets right and gets his legs under him, he's going to be able to come back at you at the other end. He can't even do that right now, so he's a real liability.
Before we let you go, we're talking to Tim Legler here on the Michael Kay Show. What are your thoughts on Porzingis? Is he a superstar? I don't think he is. He doesn't stay on the floor. He doesn't play with intensity every single game. I know he's just 22 years old, but, you know, unicorn this, unicorn that. I'm not seeing it. What about you?
I am not sure that, you know, I personally don't believe that Kristaps Porzingis is your best player that you're really going to be a threat to win a championship. I think if he's surrounded by, you know, two other all-star type players, and with his unique, you know, size and diverse skill set, you've got something really special on your hands if that's your team. I think the fact that he has really fallen in love with being a perimeter-based player, and when he first came into the league, I love the fact that he mixed it up, even for a guy that had that kind of frame. You know, he'd come along the baseline and dunk on somebody. He didn't mind throwing an elbow. And I was impressed by his toughness. As he's gotten more skilled offensively, more comfortable shooting the ball from the perimeter, it seems like that's where he wants to live all the time. And guys can get into his body. They can knock him out off his spot a little bit more. Kind of put up numbers because they don't have the kind of team that's going to stop that. He is their best offensive player. He's going to score a lot. I don't know that he has the type of overall game and toughness and ability to play against great defensive pressure that's going to lead you somewhere if he's your best player.
Are you an Eagles?